So we're going to talk about DevOps and microservices. So how many of you are building microservices in your organization? Okay, a lot of them. And how many of you are DevOps engineers versus developers? Like DevOps engineers? Okay, a lot of DevOps engineers. Good. And any developers? Okay, great. So let's see. So what's one of the, like what we're going to talk about are the challenges in building microservices, especially in the context of DevOps. So we feel, I think the number one challenge is DevOps is just hard, right? So why is DevOps hard? The DevOps is hard because it fundamentally requires multiple skill sets in a single individual. So you need to be an operator. So you need to understand operations, life sites, when things go wrong, how to fix it, and whatnot. You need to be a security person, so who understands all the security controls and whatnot, right? I mean, like, there are boatloads of them. And then if you are in a regulated industry, there are compliance standards which sort of dictate how security needs to be done. So you need to be an operator, you need to be a security person with an understanding of compliance, and you need to be a programmer who can write infrastructure as code. Historically, these three things have, or four things have not been in the same discipline. Developers are not operators, operators are not developers or programmers. So that's one. The second thing is that if this by itself was not hard enough, microservices makes it even harder. So why is that? Simple answer, too many moving pieces. Oh, no. So, too many moving pieces, right? So many different services, so many endpoints. You have to do the same thing again. Every path has to be secured. Every path has to be, like, there are DNS configurations. There are, like, config parameters. So everything just gets multiplied a lot. So that's the nature of basically microservice. Like, developers like it because, technically they can release services with a smaller surface area, and then they can release it as many times. But it definitely makes the life of DevOps engineers a much harder. Kubernetes is a beast by itself to manage. I don't know, there's probably an industry of $500 million trying to help you make Kubernetes easier. So now let's say you do figure these things out. Right, as a DevOps engineer, you have written your Terraform code and stuff. It's automated. You know, we commonly hear everything is automated in our infrastructure. But when we talk to developers, they have sometimes different set of needs. They want self-service. They want to be able to make the changes themselves. And sometimes what we see is that the best self-service that they sort of get is be able to trigger a CI/CD pipeline, which changes a Docker image, let's say, in a particular service. Right? Well, everything was automated. Why can't I just go and create my own S3 buckets or my own RDS instance and so on? You again have to go back to the DevOps engineers to actually sort of like make that automation. Because typically in the DevOps world, when somebody says automation, it's automation meant for the purposes of the DevOps engineers themselves. Well, there is definitely this thing called platform engineering, which is coming up more, wherein like engineers are sort of building platforms for DevOps engineers are building platforms for the consumption of developers. But as of today, doing self-service becomes very hard. And then you have to manage IAM permissions, you have to give permissions, you have to take permissions. It's much harder. Ironically, infrastructure as a code, a lot of developers don't understand Terraform because there is so much of operator knowledge and compliance and security requirements that are there. They just don't understand. They require a higher level abstraction. So that's where I think things sort of like get complicated. So, you know, people are saying that why don't we shift left security? So what is shift left security? Shift left security basically means look at security and address security needs as early as possible in the workflow. Now, what does it mean when you're creating resources, like put in all the security controls and stuff? Now, if you have to shift left security and at the same time also give developer self-service access, you need to have tremendous amount of automation and sometimes even an abstraction which engineering teams could sort of like leverage so that when you actually deploy an infrastructure, it already has the compliance controls in place. So what I'm trying to basically say is that security has to be built into the automation versus you trying to manually bake in every control. Terraform is a programming language or CloudFormation in that sense, or a DSL, right? I mean, it doesn't write itself. It doesn't tell you. Well, there are, you know, a lot of tools who are helping you in that process. But a lot of them are like, OK, I'm going to give you ready-made modules. They're going to lint your code to tell you if something is wrong and so forth. But end of the day, it still requires an operator to have substantial subject matter expertise. So fundamentally, what I'm trying to get to is that if you are an organization, let's say you are a DevOps engineer or a platform engineer, you are trying to build, or you have microservices, your engineers are using microservices, you're building automation, and you want security to be built in. I think you need to build an automation that's not just meant for yourself. It needs to be meant for your developers. So there is some sense of platform engineering that needs to come in, and it should be usable by engineers. It has to provide a much higher level abstraction. They don't need to understand the lower level details of operations, IAM role, instance profiles, and so on. And the bottom line is the system has to work without you. I mean, I think the best DevOps engineer is one who can automate themselves out of their jobs effectively, right? But very rarely do we see the size of DevOps engineers, DevOps teams basically grow smaller in size. It just grows bigger in size. Why is that? Because fundamentally, they're building systems for their own usage, and engineers are sort of like behind them waiting for things to be done. So I think in that sense, fortunately, the industry has evolved a lot. And people are building abstractions. I think there are a lot of good talks about like various large organizations having built their own platforms. In fact, Spinnaker is one of them. These guys from, I think, Netflix have built that. I think the guys from Spotify, I think, built something. So there are like Uber guys have built something and so forth. But most of them, I think, while they solved the problem, but they did not solve the problem in a more generic way. So, but if you look more in the industry now, I think more and more platform engineering companies are coming in, and then there are like more platform softwares, I think. And we are actually one of them. At DuploCloud, our goal is to provide DevOps as a service, install a software in a cloud account of yours, and then it provides a low-code, no-code interface for engineers and DevOps teams to consume. So, and while you are going through that journey of automation, I think it's very important to have all the right KPIs. Right? Before you say everything is automated, which I hear all the time from DevOps engineers, like DevOps engineers are like everything is automated, but engineers are always waiting. So coming back to like what we have done at DuploCloud is we have built a DevOps as a service platform. It runs, the software runs in a virtual machine in your cloud account, in this case Amazon. And then the developers can provide a much higher level specifications. Like, OK, you can say, give me an environment, make it compliant to so-and-so standard, PCI, HIPAA, SOC 2, whatever. I need all the logging, monitoring, alerting to be set up automatically. Give me the right set of hooks for CI/CD. And I should be able to do pretty much everything that I need in terms of building, maintaining, and operating an infrastructure. So DevOps, in true senses, developers doing operations, basically, right? And the DevOps engineers, on the other hand, can set all the guardrails, security principles, and whatnot, but they don't have to be in the middle of the daily operations. So that's sort of the vision that we have, like an all-in-one DevOps as a service platform. And we will actually show you a demo of how approximately looks like. But the intent over here is that you can look at this demo, and if you are building something on this on your own, you can see how close this is. But as a concept, hopefully it makes sense. So let's do this. I think what we are trying to do basically here is that we are trying to build an infrastructure which basically they have a VPC. The infrastructure is split into multiple availability zones, containers in Kubernetes. You want an RDS instance, S3, and maybe expose it via web application firewall. So you can expose, I mean, the software installs in your cloud account. So there is a no-code interface wherein you don't have to write any code, or you can use a Terraform provider. So you can start by basically building an infrastructure, basically by providing a high-level application specifications. I think it's going to be hard for me to follow. We'll probably skip this because there's supposed to be audio along this video, and that is not playing. So I'm just going to skip this, but this is on our website, and you can sort of watch through this. But the, at a high level, what it is trying to do is that you can very quickly create a new environment, and inside the environment, you can go and then sort of like add any arbitrary cloud resource and compose your own infrastructure. Like you can add an EC2 instance, you can drop in an S3 bucket, the system automatically manages all the IAM roles, instance profiles, and all those combinations. You can create RDS databases that can manage your, take your username, password, encrypt it, save it into Secrets Manager, install the Kubernetes driver, map it to Kubernetes secrets, make it all ready and good to go with respect to how the containers are deployed and use the secrets in environmental variables. And overall, I mean, it provides you a very higher level abstraction and kind of a platform that engineers can use themselves. Like what this we are doing right now is that we are trying to deploy a Kubernetes service to the system, and then you can expose it via load balancer by simply providing, you know, the protocol port and so forth. And behind the scenes, the system automatically goes and generates ingress controllers, node ports, and whatnot. And the system not only allows you to deploy things, it also helps you operate. Like you can come in and you quickly look at the container logs. You can actually get into the shell of the container, no access control required. You can even get into the Kubernetes shell, scope to a tenant or an environment, so you just see your own namespace. And then, you know, you can even get into the AWS console through the system. So you get into a tenant, let's say you want to get into the S3 console. You click on that S3 bucket, and then there's a option to click console. What the system does is that it uses the federated APIs in AWS and generates a just-in-time access login scope to that S3 bucket. So that way, you also have access to S3 bucket. And you can pretty much use, like I was saying, any Amazon service, Lambda, ECS, Kubernetes, RDS, ElastiCache, SageMaker. And in this case, I think we are deploying the Lambda function. And then like we are sort of like testing. So once, let's say, you have weaved your infrastructure, what the system automatically does is that it integrates logging, monitoring, alerting. For example, monitoring, we are doing Prometheus, Grafana. It's all built into the system. Like environment by environment, you get your a sort of like dashboards. You can similarly, all your logs are set up. The system is using Filebeat, Kibana, and Elasticsearch. Alerts can be easily set up using CloudWatch and pipe to, you know, Sentry, a pager duty, and the desired system of your choice. And all of this is happening while compliance controls are automatically pushed. You can do, you have billing dashboards for FinOps. You can do billing service by service. You have a SIM solution integrated into the system wherein you can sort of see how everything is compliant and alerts and everything else are so, sort of set up. Like all of this is happening behind the scenes while the engineers can completely operate the system. And while you seeing this in sort of a video, you can do everything that you see over here with the same simplicity in Terraform as well. By we have a Terraform provider, basically. So it's think of it like an SDK into Terraform. It's like this. I mean, that entire system that you, the diagram that you saw that we deployed can be done in about like 100 lines of code. And you don't have to understand, and it'll all be like PCI HIPAA compliant, and you don't have to understand any of these details. So this is sort of a platform that I was sort of talking about, something that can be used by your engineers as well. So, I mean, yeah, we have like several case studies. Like this is one of our premier customers who have like a lot of engineers, like 50 plus engineers. They're managing 1,000 Docker containers and several applications on Amazon, 100% self-service, hundreds of deployments a week, with basically supported by one or two DevOps engineers. A little bit about the validation. I think we're reasonably mature, 75 plus customers, 1,000 plus users, developer and DevOps. 50,000 plus infrastructure changes. So what does this infrastructure mean? This is not a CI/CD pipeline triggering a build. This is somebody creating a SageMaker instance or an ElastiCache or an RDS of anything of that sort, pretty much. And cloud services, these are like the Amazon cloud services, like Redis, Elastic, Redis, RDS, SageMaker, Airflow, Kubernetes, ECS, and whatnot. Security really is our bread and butter. We have worked with the customers, and last year we did enabled 45-plus compliance certification from SOC 2 to HIPAA to PCI. And I think one thing to be noted is that we're also not like we just give you the software and walk away. We always have this option of professional services that goes to the extent of embedding DevOps engineers into your team and enabling you to build this entire system and operate it end-to-end if you're a larger organization. And yeah, that's pretty much it. But in summary, I think the idea of having a platform enabling engineers to do self-service versus building an automation purely for DevOps engineers is probably how the future is going to look like what we say as DevOps as a service. Just like infrastructure as a service has happened, DevOps as a service ought to happen using software. Thank you.